I'm your host for this edition of Rescue the Lost Ministry. My name is John Fontana, and you've tuned in to Rescue the Lost Ministry. We're an evangelical outreach we have a burden for the lost. And tonight's subject is a good one. I might say that all the time. This is a real good one. What is Christianity? What is Christianity? But before that, as always, we give you our computer info. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, and prayer requests, you can phone us at 1-877-676-2288. That's 1-877-676-2288. Skype, Selah Radio 1. Any questions, comments, concerns, or even prayer requests, our email is raise4him@yahoo.com. Raise, R-A-Z, the number 4, forhim@yahoo.com. You can join our Facebook page, live chat on soulwinnerswithaz.org, Facebook Spreaker, listen on TuneIn app for iPhone, iPad, iPod, and all Android devices. Enter Selah, S-E-L-A-H, radios 24/7 in search. What is Christianity? Well, Christianity is a word not appearing in the New Testament, but it's designating the Christian faith as founded on the life and teachings of Christ and his apostles. Christianity, though rooted in Judaism, was and is an entirely new but true religion, since one receives a new heart, a new spirit, and a new covenant or testament, a new song, and becomes a new creation. So all things become new. It is a revelation of God through his Son, Jesus Christ. It is a way of life based on a personal experience in relationship with Christ and obedience to his commandments. And it is also a godly determination to further God's kingdom by Christ's disciples. Thank God for Christianity. In short, Christianity is Christ. In other words, Christianity is all summed up in him, in Christ. The Watchman Nee says, the distinctive feature of true Christianity is that it compels people to receive. And what does one receive? One receives Christ. That simple. The person becomes a Christian and then has Christ's life. It is Christ indwelling the person. And so Christ in the person becomes the person's life and lives in that person instead of the person. Not that the person doesn't live, but it's more the Christ living in the person if he really sows to the Spirit, or she. Now, God gives Christ, which is his Son, to the person to be his life. That is the glorious exchange, and it all happens and begins at the cross. Nee wrote this, "The cross terminates the first creation, and out of death there is brought in a new creation in Christ, the second man, which is the second Adam." Christianity begins with the new birth, of course, being born again of God's Spirit, and it continues with progressive sanctification, the process of purification of the believer to transform him or her into Christ's image. Man is created in God's image, but Christianity conforms the believer into Christ's image. It is not an automatic process. The onus is on the believer to voluntarily choose to no longer live for himself, but Christ to live in him. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2:2, For I did not pretend to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. The highest responsibility of man is simply to cooperate with God and not hinder His working. A colossal problem, Nee writes, exists among God's children today. The Christianity they know is quite fragmentary. You obtain a little grace, you receive a little gift, and one speaks a little in tongues. This person experiences some change in his conduct. That person possesses some measure of God's love. This one has some patience. That one has some humility. This is what is commonly known as Christianity. But is this Christianity? It is not. For Christianity is not a little of something. Furthermore, Christianity is not a lot. Christianity is none other than Christ Himself. God has not granted us humility and patience and gentleness. He grants the entire Christ to us, who is our humility and patience. It is Christ living in us and through us who becomes what I mentioned, humility, patience, and gentleness, and the rest of the fruit of the Spirit. It is Christ, the living Lord. This is truly Christianity. Once again, Christianity is Christ, and the life of a Christian is also Christ. Christianity is the life within you, speaking to every situation in your life. It is only when the Spirit of God moves within a believer that he or she can tell what is really right and pleasing to God. A Christian should only do what the life within him or her allows them to do. Hence, the issue is not a matter of right and wrong, which is religion. Rather, it is a matter of whether the life within you approves or disproves. Nee writes, Christianity is neither the elimination of weakness nor the power of the Lord alone. It is the Lord's power manifested in man's weakness. 2 Corinthians 12:9. This is what Christianity is all about. Nee also said, what is the highest attainment of Christianity? It is a complete union with God and total loss of self. The union with Christ cannot be obtained when a believer has a secret attachment and union with the world and idols still on the throne in his heart. Nee writes, alas, Christianity, in the experience of most Christians, is an endeavor to be what they are not and an endeavor to do what they cannot do. They are always struggling to not love the world because at heart they really love it. Like the song goes, I don't care, I love it. And so they are always trying to be humble because at heart they're still proud. You see, Christianity involves our personal knowledge of God directly through the Holy Spirit. You can underscore that. There are many who look to the letter of the word even more than to Jesus Christ Himself as their final authority. But this is not true Christianity, for true Christianity is not based on information, but on personal revelation from God. Information or doctrine is always external and impersonal, but Christianity is a revealed religion, and revelation is always inward, direct, and personal. Christianity is not the earthen vessel, nor is it the treasure inside, but it is the combination of the treasure within the earthen vessel. Why? So that it is not the earthen vessel, but the power of God that is the exceeding greatness within, lest anyone should boast of himself or herself. 2 Corinthians 4:7. Christianity is not a matter of faith only, but of faith triumphing in the presence of doubt. Here is Christianity. Not that we camouflage the vessel by hardening ourselves to suppress all feeling, but that we let the earthen vessel be seen with the treasure inside. It is not a case of getting through painful situations because one has become insensitive to pain, but rather of retaining attaining full consciousness and being carried through by another, that is Christ, despite the feeling of pain. The glory of Christianity is that God's treasure will be manifested in the humblest vessel of clay. Christianity is a paradox, and it is as we Christians live out our lives in this paradox that we get into, that we get to know God. Indeed, the further we go on in the Christian life, the more of a paradox our lives become. For the treasure within becomes increasingly manifest as the earthen vessel remains just an earthen vessel. We still have this human nature, and we're still human, more to the point. And what is the paradox of the Christian life? To die is to live. When weak, you are strong, and less is more in Christ. Death in Christ finishes a man. God's power is made perfect in weakness, and he must increase, I must decrease. All that is Christianity. Real Christianity is an out-of-the-box way of looking at things. It's through the Spirit. It is seeing with dove's eyes the risen Lord, like the Shulamite woman in the Song of Solomon. It's having the eyes of our hearts enlightened to truth. While man trusts in his own mind, his thinking is futile, limited, and foolish. Those believers who walk in the Spirit see things from God's perspective. They see what matters. They behold the Godhead, the glory, and have vision in him and revelation of God, his word, and the things of God. They see themselves and hate sin and self and its destructiveness. Their gaze is upon the Lord, and they see the reality of this life. Christianity is not for the faint-hearted and the spineless. It is for those strong in the Lord. It is for the fully committed, for those who love God with everything within them, who seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and want to do his will, not their own, no matter what. It is for those who love not their life unto death, as long as God is glorified. Amen to that. In true Christianity, the emphasis is to please God and not men. It's into obeying God and not men also, when a choice is to be made between the two. That's found in Acts 5:29. When a Christian practices true Christianity, he turns the other cheek, goes the extra mile, is quick to forgive, is compassionate, he stands up for the truth and defends it, he's merciful and kind, he overlooks an offense, and he even loves his enemies. In short, he's into doing God's will eagerly and joyfully because he loves God so much. Now, there are major enemies of Christianity that are an affront to God. Some of them are communism, Islam, humanism, New Age, the occult, and atheism, to name a few. I'm not going to address all of them, but I want to talk about three of them. Communism, Islam, and humanism. First of all, I'd like to give a description of communism by way of its characteristics in order to define it. A person who is a communist is a brainwashed tool in the hands of communists. He cannot think for himself, but only acts on what he is told. The Russians are a people raised from childhood believing in communism, propaganda, and atheism. Tozer said, Christianity is religion of freedom. People who are communists are bound up, because if you know the truth and the truth is in Jesus, Jesus is the truth and he will set you free. What he said of communism, is Tozer that is this: it is a wicked ideology that has been organized into a world conspiracy. It is shrewd, cruel, inhuman, or inhumane, and fanatically determined. He said it is the devil's most cunning and most effective imitation of Christianity to date, which was when he lived the 20th century, he said that. Now, communism came to power in the fall of 1944. so it's as old as I am. I'm going to be 70 this June. So it came to power through violence and hatred. Richard Warmbrand, in his book Tortured for Christ, and I recommend you read that, which I will quote from extensively, said, once the communists came to power, they skillfully used the means of seduction toward the church. Thousands of priests, pastors, and ministers did not know how to discern between the voice of communism and Christianity. 4,000 of these priests, pastors, and ministers of all denominations, they chose Joseph Stalin, of all people, as their leader. At that same time, you know what Stalin was into? He was the president of the World Movement of the Godless. And in the process, he was a mass murderer of Christians. One after another, bishops and pastors declared that communism and Christianity are fundamentally the same and could coexist. Do you believe that? Well, history repeats itself. Today there has risen again the same counterfeit spirit of unity called ecumenicalism. Well, the true ecumenical spirit is when Jesus said, I have other sheep, not of this fold. I wish they'd be united with me also. The counterfeit of this is the religion called, in our day, Chrislam. That's the satanic antichrist mixture of Christianity and Islam. If you can't beat them, join them. Since Satan can't beat true Christianity, especially doctrinally, he joins with it to overthrow it. Does he not disguise himself as an angel of light? He certainly does. Well, Orthodox and Protestant church leaders competed with each other in yielding to communism. An Orthodox bishop put a hammer and sickle on his robes and asked his priest to no longer call him Your Grace, but Comrade Bishop. He certainly became a Judas. Other priests were more direct. Rapp, and his name is spelled with two P's, who was the deputy bishop of the Lutheran Church in Romania, began to teach in the theological seminary that God had given him three revelations, one through Moses, one through Jesus, and one through Stalin, the last Stalin superseding Jesus before. The president of the Baptists praised Stalin as a great teacher of the Bible. Come on now. And proclaimed that Satan did nothing but fulfill the commandments of God. But true Baptists did not agree and were faithful to Christ. They suffered much because they stood up courageously for the truth, for the Lord. So communists are unhappy, many commit suicide. How unhappy Stalin was after killing nearly all of his old comrades. Could you imagine his seared, guilty conscience? He was constantly in fear of being poisoned or killed himself. Communism makes no one happy, not even its dictators. They need Christ. The underground church hates communism, but loves the communists. Richard Warmbrand's wife Sabrina's entire family, who was Jewish, died in Nazi concentration camps, and Sabrina and Richard had the privilege of inviting a Nazi who had been at one of those camps to their home. They fed him, loved him, and brought him to Christ. This Christianity Christ loves, and the Father loves, and applauds, as do his committed followers. God is love, and Satan is hatred personified. Anything or anyone God loves, Satan hates with intense hatred. That's why Satan hates both Jew and Christian, for they are God's people whom he loves. For that matter, anything God and his people hate, like evil, Satan and his captive followers love, like wickedness and darkness. So it follows that Satan really uses communism, which is fueled by Satan's violence and hatred. Christianity, in fact, happens to be the most hated religion on the planet. I'd like to express to you how far gone a communist mind is brainwashed. When Richard Warmbrand was in prison, he witnessed. And in witnessing to communists, he said this: "It was not easy to talk to them. I told them the parable of the man who had 100 sheep and lost one. They did not understand, as they were brainwashed with the communist ideology. They asked, how is it that he has 100 sheep? Has not the communist collective farm taken them all away? Then he said, Jesus is a king. They answered, all the kings have been bad men who control the people, so Jesus must also be a dictator. Richard and other incarcerated Christians learned that to preach the gospel to communists after so many years of communist indoctrination, they had to use an entirely new approach. And in your witnessing today, you might have to be led to the Spirit, by the Spirit, to witness to religious people in a different way if it doesn't work, the method that you're using. So what they did, they had to translate the gospel into the Marxist language in order for them to identify with it. It was something they could not do by themselves, but the Holy Spirit did his work through them. Warmbrand said, Russians are rarely superficial or shallow in religious matters, whether they fight against religion or were for it and sought Christ. They put their whole soul into it. That is why under communism in Russia, Christians were soul winners, and they believed every soul won for Christ must be made a soul winner. Russians that were converted became members in the underground church. They were reckless and daring for Christ, always saying it was the least they could do for Christ who died for them. They had beautiful hearts, and they still do today. We Christians in America ought to learn a lesson from their attitude and example regarding sharing our faith. The secret police in Russia greatly persecuted the underground church because they recognized in it the only effective resistance left against communism. It was just the kind of resistance, a spiritual resistance, that if left unhindered, would undermine their atheistic power. They recognized, as only the devil can, an immediate threat to them. They knew that if a man believed in Christ, he would never be a mindless, willing subject that communists are. They knew that they could imprison the physical body, but they couldn't imprison a man's spirit, his faith in God. And so they fought hard against Christianity. But Christianity prevails over communism as light overcomes darkness. If God be for a believer, who dare be against us? Amen? The prisons were full, and in Romania, as in all communist countries, to be in prison means to be tortured. The torturers were unspeakably horrible. The tortures. Some were so horrible that Richard Warmbrand preferred not to speak too much about those atrocities he received, since they were so unbearably painful. If he mentioned them, he would remember them and wouldn't be able to sleep at night. It was that bad. What the communists have done to Christians this day and continue to do surpasses any possibility of human understanding. The lengths to which a man can be inhumane. It's unbelievable. Warmbrand said he has seen communists whose faces, while torturing believers, shone with rapturous joy. They cried out while torturing Christians, "We are the devil." Do you believe it? The cruelty of atheism is hard to believe. For them, nothing but matter exists, and to them, a man is like wood or an eggshell. Like, you know, they don't feel anything. They are materialists. The communist torturers often said, "There is no God in hereafter and no punishment for evil. We can do what we wish." One torturer said, "I thank God, in whom I don't believe," and that's an interesting statement, "that I have lived to this hour, when I can express all the evil in my heart. Wow. He expressed it in unbelievable brutality and torture inflicted on prisoners. He also said, "I'm very sorry if a crocodile eats a man, but I can't reproach the crocodile. He's not a moral being. So no reproaches can be made to the communists. Communism has destroyed any moral sense in them. They boasted that they had no pity in their hearts." Warmbrand said, "I've learned from them. As they allowed no place for Jesus in their hearts, I decided I would not leave the smallest place for Satan in mine." That's a beautiful statement. Communism is defeated with the love of Christ. It was in prison that Brother Warmbrand and other Christians found the hope of salvation for the communists. It was there that he and others developed a sense of responsibility toward them. It was in being tortured by them that they learned to love them. Communist hatred blinds, but only love can change the communists and the terrorists, and any sinner for that matter. Christ and his apostles and all the great teachers of Christianity have taught this universal love in his name. Not to love is sin, because a Christian knows he ought to love. And James 4:17 says, "To him who knows what is right fails to do it, to him or her it is sin." Many Christians are often half-heartedly on the side of the whole truth. Communists are wholeheartedly on the side of the lie. And that's a shameful fact. Communism has killed 30 million Russians, millions of Chinese, and Jews and Americans are inclusive, of course. Christians, again, should love the communists, but denounce communism. Today in North Korea, thousands of Christians are in prison camps for years under communist rule. The average prison sentence is 15 years, and the average life expectancy for a prisoner is only 5 years. Yet Koreans willingly embrace Christ's gospel. Good for them. As one writer puts it, as long as there have been Korean Christians, there have been Koreans ready to die for their faith. Scholars estimate that at least 1 million Koreans have died in prison camps. The beating and killing of prisoners by the guards is not only tolerated in such camps, but encouraged. In 1968, Kim Tu-sung, who claimed to be God and was worshipped as God by North Koreans, instructed guards in prison camps not to feel the slightest humanity or empathy for what they thought were low Christians at low class. They classified them as low class enemies. That's projection there. After the Korean War, 50,000 Christians existed, but 80% of them worshipped underground to avoid communist persecution. And here, my brothers and sisters, hear the plea of your North Korean brothers as I speak right now, and sisters, pray for us. Pray for us. That's all they say. Don't be indifferent to their plight. They cry in their hearts, as do many of persecuted Christians throughout the world. Don't write us off. Scripture says, in Hebrews 13:3, "Remember those who are in prison as though you were a prisoner with them. Remember those who endure affliction and adversity, because you are part of Christ's body." You should empathize with them and feel their affliction, in the spirit, of course. You see, besides Russia and North Korea, as I speak, Christians are persecuted, tortured, and killed in other restricted countries such as Colombia, Pakistan, India, Indonesia, an odd country called Eritrea, India, and Sudan. A Christian worker in Southeast Asia shared this: "Police do not like it when Christianity spreads to a village that had no Christian before. Christian workers say that when police hear of new converts to Christ, they befriend them and find out who told them about Jesus, and they go after them, for those people who evangelize, and beat, arrest, fine, and otherwise threaten them to stop spreading the gospel. Hush up, they say. The government is now pressuring thousands of new converts to give up Christianity and return to their tribal religion. Their response was, oh, I love their response, whether or not you allow us to worship God, we are going to continue to worship God anyway. So there. What possesses believers to have joy carrying boxes of Bibles to a remote village in Southeast Asia? It's their love of God which gives them the joy of the Lord, and it's expressed and manifested on their faces. Because of this labor of love for the brethren, the Bible distribution in Southeast Asia, Pastor Ho, H-O-A, said, now we have 5,000 believers in the mountains. The love and thirst for God is in Voice of the Martyrs ministry, who have received requests by 191,267 believers who have asked for a Bible, one Bible. After knowing that fact, what Christian would be challenged to read his Bible more, especially if he owns more than one? Now let's focus on Islam. According to the Quran, anyone who doesn't convert to the Islamic faith and become a Muslim, he is an infidel and is to be put to death. Now, if that's not part of Satan's agenda for mankind, what is? In John 10:10, Satan came to steal, kill, and destroy. The whole world watched in shock and in horror when the unprecedented attack on the U.S. came on September 11th, 2001 in Lower Manhattan, New York City, when Islamic terrorists crashed two planes into the Twin Tower buildings, killing 3,000 innocent people. God allowed evil, Al-Qaeda, a terrorist network which Osama bin Laden headed, to carry out the planned atrocity. Why did God allow it? I believe because America had long abandoned the godly Judeo-Christian principles it was founded on, and so the hedge of protection over the U.S. was removed. Once America compromised on Christianity, the nation was open to its enemy or enemies. Along with that was President Obama's administration to be too liberal toward Muslim countries. So what has been this country's policy toward Muslims? It is, don't offend them. Look what it has gotten us. People who should know better are lauding Islam and demeaning Christianity. Says Jan Markle of Olive Tree Ministries, she goes on to say, you can offend and even persecute Christians, but don't you dare try to do that to a Muslim. Taken internationally, the evil Muslim Brotherhood is a protected species, and Israel is going on the endangered species list. The FBI training manuals in America are now scrubbed of negative Islamic references. You know, truth has fallen in the public squares. You can't pray. You say the name Jesus, you're in trouble. And so on. At the same time, Christians everywhere are taking a hit from what I just mentioned, to put it mildly. However, some are being exterminated, particularly in the Middle East and Africa. America and the rest of the world have seen the cruel beheading of a Jewish American and others on TV. This is also in the Quran. That is what will be the fate of Allah's enemies, especially the Jew and American. In 1998, there was the attack on the USS Cole. Al-Qaeda, in close allegiance with the Taliban regime, allowed them to operate with impunity in pursuing their terrorist activities. One of their stated aims is the murder of U.S. citizens and the military and attacks on America's allies. Of course, another plane crashed into the Pentagon in 2001, and another was headed for the White House. Thanks to heroic passengers on board, that plane didn't make it to the White House and crashed in a field in Pennsylvania. Speaking of the White House, on July 11, 1997, an appointed Palestinian leader, Sheikh Ekrima Zabri, preached a sermon at the ancient Al-Aqsa Mosque on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. It was broadcast on Voice of Palestine Radio. He said, "O Allah," which means the praised one, "destroy America, for she is ruled by Zionist Jews. Allah will paint the White House black." The Muslims say to Britain, to France, and to all the infidel nations. That's what they, what do they say? They say that Jerusalem is Arab. The only relevant party is the Islamic Nation. Some other Muslims said this, that the Arab flag will fly over the White House. Isn't it odd that one of the colors in Arabic flag is black? Black scripturally speaks of sin, darkness, death, and Satan. We spoke of communism. Isn't it also odd that the communist Russian flag and Chinese flags are red? Red scripturally has to do with blood. We've already mentioned how much blood has been shed and is and will be shed by all communist nations. I believe there were two Russian terrorists, the young men who bombed and killed many people, children included, at the Boston Marathon, which, by the way, this month of April is now the first anniversary of the bombing. Excuse me. Benghazi was another terrorist attack on the U.S. Embassy, there killing a U.S. ambassador and three other Americans. Fort Hood, and there's been a recent shooting there too, in Texas, had a terrorist and an Arab U.S. officer, many of you are aware of, and he killed several soldiers. As he shot them, he praised Allah. His case is still pending, though. Now, President Obama has done nothing more than tickle the tail of the dragon in his liberal don't offend policy to Muslims. To make matters worse, he has the audacity to call himself a Christian. He once said, I don't wear my Christianity on my sleeve. Well, he doesn't know the Bible that says, "Set me as a seal upon my heart and upon my arm," which is sleeve. It's that Song of Solomon 8:6. What a hypocrite and deceiver, trying to dupe the American people for political advantage. He had an appointment to speak at a prestigious Christian college and said to those who arranged his speaking engagement, "Please cover up any religious Christian things." He said this and wanted it done so as not to offend other religions, Muslim included. This is the norm today in the godless society that we live in. The chief common denominator between the three main religions of the world, Christianity, Jews, and Muslims, is that they all are monotheistic. However, they all, and in the fact that they all worship one God, however, only the Muslims worship a different God, Allah. The Jews worship their God and await their Messiah, who is Yeshua, Jesus, although a veil covers their eyes in that truth. Then there is humanism. Oh, there's so much to say about that. I hope I can get it in. Humanism by Bert Thompson, and he is of the Apologetic Press. His writing on humanism is excellent. He opens his introduction on the subject with this statement: "Absolute truth belongs only to one class of humans, the class of absolute fools." These are the piercing words of Ashley Montague. He's a famous evolutionist/humanist of Princeton University. Dr. Montague wanted to make it clear that at best truth is relative, and anyone who states differently is to be categorized a fool, quote unquote. Sir Julian Huxley joined Montague in this kind of thinking. For instance, said, "We must now be prepared to abandon the God hypothesis and its corollaries like divine revelation or unchanging truth, and to change over from a supernatural to a naturalistic view of human destiny." Why do these men make such statements? The answer, it seems, lies in an ever-increasing attitude of supreme self-sufficiency, a burning carnal desire to cut themselves loose from, to their thinking, the apron strings of God, as it were. The humanist says, "We can, if we so choose, do virtually anything." But is that the only reason for this debunking of God in favor of a purely human vantage point? No. What it is a willful determination on the part of man not to have God in his mind or in his life, and instead to replace him with something, anything, non-divine and non-supernatural. It is a concerted effort to escape any ultimate responsibility and instead to find a way to allow each person to do his own thing. And that's the crux of the matter. There is nothing left to the imagination when it comes to the tenets of humanism. Since its inception in 1933, humanists have taken aim at God, religion, the supernatural, and the gospel message. Humanists still believe, after all those years until now, that traditional theism, especially faith in the prayer-healing God, assumed to love and care for persons, is nothing but an unproved and outmoded faith. You see, humanists believe in cultures such as ours that religion is often an alien form of life to intellectuals. Living as we do in a post-Enlightenment era, they say, it is difficult for us to take religion seriously. The very concept seems fantastic to us, that people in our age can believe that they have a personal encounter with God, that they could believe that they have experienced conversion through a mystical experience of God, so that they are born again in the Spirit, is something that attests to human irrationality and a lack of sense of reality. Really? The message is clear. Those people, they say, who accept God, His Son, His Word, and His salvation are out of touch with reality, irrational, and unreasonable. Although Christ, the truth, means reality. Now, they say that we believe, however, that traditional or dogmatic or even authoritative religion that places revelation, God, creed above human needs and experience actually does a disservice to the human species. They say we strive for a good life here and now. And I mentioned a previous webcast that's Satan's Church. Their tenet is the here and now. They don't look to the future. Christians do, and therein we have eternal life. Let me cut this short by saying that humanism and Christianity, they even say, and it's true, are mutually exclusive and diametrically opposed systems. But they say, which is a lie, that no one can possess absolute truth, that there is no life after death, that views of salvation are illusionary and harmful, that man is the most important thing in the universe, that man has no soul, and there is no heaven or hell. It is the Christian system that places man in its proper place in the universe. Man is not up from the slime as humanists advocate through evolution, but instead he comes down from heaven. And God says the wisdom that man values so highly, God often sees as nothing and foolish and vain. We must, as believers, oppose humanism because its teachings are contrary to the teaching of God's word. We must come to understand and help others to understand the folly of human wisdom, such as is found in humanism. And you can check all that out in 1 Corinthians 1, passage 19 to 21, as I don't have the time. Christians must reject humanism and help others to do the same. So much for humanism. Trying to get everything in. So I'd like to mention now about C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis, who was the great Christian apologist during World War II, he became a champion of Orthodox Christianity. He fought for what he believed to be true. He was committed to defending and helping us understand basic Christianity. He said Christianity is about repentance and forgiveness. And in his classic book, Mere Christianity, he said that first of all, we must as individuals come to grips with our own need to be forgiven. Until we do this, we're not likely to understand Christianity. He said man has fallen and he has rebelled against God, and the only way out of his hole is surrender, what Christianity means by repentance. Repentance is no fun, and it is much harder than eating humble pie, he said. He also said the supreme vice for Christianity is the diabolical self. About faith, he said, it has two levels of senses. The first sense is belief, accepting the doctrines of Christianity as true. The second sense is to realize that we are proud. The real Christianity blows to bits the idea that we can simply perform and be good Christians. He said, unfortunately, people stop trying at all and give up their faith, that if you stick with it, you soon discover something that God gives you everything you need to please him. Lewis said, Christians are like the boy who goes to his father to ask for money to buy his father a present. Realizing these two things about faith helps Christians, whereby God can really begin to work in us. He said that some things in Christianity cannot be understood from outside, but it can only be understood after going down the Christian road. He said that putting on Christ so that we can at last change into a real son and daughter of God is the whole of Christianity. And the idea of God's dying on the cross to pay my debt and yours is the atonement, the wonderful design of redemption, which the Father put in place before the foundation of the world. This, wrote Lewis, is at the heart of Christianity. So, I'd like to mention what Tozer said. What's wrong with Christianity? What then is wrong with Christianity? Why the inertia, the apathy, the lethargy, the dullness, stagnation, compromise, hype, and status quo? And there are other things too much to mention. What passes for Christianity these days is ridiculous. You have the TV evangelists with their health and wealth gospel, the name it and claim it gospel, the prosperity preachers, and the power of positive thinking that came through Robert Schuller. It goes on and on. It's just outlandish and stupid. But this is what Tozer said. Number one, about what's wrong with Christianity. We insist upon making Christianity a form of amusement, and we want to have fun. Two, we are afflicted with religious myopia, which is a narrow view of something, and we see only things at hand, like a car, a house, whatever. People are into this life. Christians can be, and that's what we're pointed to. So you have a narrow view, and you don't see the big picture. We see dimly, but then face to face, we know in part. But God gives us this word so we'll know the times and seasons of his end. That's what we're talking about. We are bogged down in local interests, and we have lost sight of eternal purposes. We are correct in doctrine, but weary of prayer and bored with God and the things of God. That's really sad. We muddle along and we hope for heaven, but show no eagerness to get there. What God is trying to do, he's trying to interest us in a glorious tomorrow, and we are settling for an inglorious today. In other words, many Christians are into the here and now of this life. In closing, I'd like to say I personally think God is fed up with people who don't want him. And so he says, if you don't want me, I'm coming back real soon for those who do want me. In fact, they can't wait to be with me. They're rapture ready. He's at the door. Be ready. I hope you're ready. I guess the final statement I'll make before the little extra time that we have and get personal with you, as I always do, I'll make this statement. So we learn and live as Christians. And as you learn, live your Christianity. All right? You know, I was at a meeting recently with Ray and getting a network help from another church. Not network, a supportive help from another church for our ministry, Rescue Lost Ministry, in terms of evangelism. And I stated something that David Jeremiah said. There's two things in the Bible and that have to do with the eternal, the Word of God and human souls. And every individual in the church and churches corporately need to invest in both, in the Word of God and in souls. And in these last days, this is what's important. You know, the next Bible study that when I spend time with you on the air, Lord willing, whenever that will be, shortly, Ray has next week, I would have the week after. I'm going to be starting, although I'll do some practical Bible studies, I'll be starting a Bible study, the first study of many studies on eschatology, the end time studies, and it will be entitled The Placebo Treatment, an interesting title that I'll explain in the Bible study. I don't want to give it away, of course, that will have to do with how Christ sees the church today through the Laodicean church. It'll be an excellent study. I hope you'll join me then when it's my turn to give the study. And I believe that all these studies that I'm getting into in my spirit, that it's getting closer and closer to the end, and that's why I'm concentrating me personally on end time studies. One of my resources will be from James Pratt's book on the Laodicean Church, and the exact title right now, but I'll announce it to you on the air, and I recommend you reading it. He's a wonderful scholar in the Hebrew and Greek, and he really was a great message on the Laodicean church, and I'll be talking about that. But I'll be doing other Bible study, practical Bible studies also here and there, but not many, as compared to the eschatological studies, get the word out. And some of which the practical ones are spiritual landmines and godly supplements and other ones. Okay, so now I have five remaining minutes with you. And I'd like to mention a little bit more on some of the that I didn't have in my notes about all the enemies of Christianity. There's also the occult, the New Age, pragmatism, and cults. There's a lot of others, but you know, when it comes to enemies, when, you know, the last enemy for a Christian to overcome will be death. But when Jesus comes, it's one of the subject of enemies, he'll have all the enemies put under his feet, even through his church. But it'll be under his feet. Okay? And that will be the final victory. And then he'll come to usher in the kingdom, the millennial kingdom, and set up his government for 1,000 years, and it'll be recommissioned, and it'll be forever, because his government shall be forever. And we'll be talking about the second coming, and we'll be talking about the seven trumpets, we'll be talking about the rapture, we'll be talking about the tribulation, Armageddon, the red heifer, some interesting stuff, and the Temple Mount, how the Jews are very much in the middle of this and why, and it goes on in end time studies. I'm really looking forward to it. We'll certainly get into the book of Revelation and Daniel, that's it contrasted with it, accompanied it. I can't say that one either. Goes along with it, I'll put it that way. So there'll be a lot that we'll be getting into in the way of the last days, and it couldn't be more relevant than now. And in your witnessing, you'll definitely have to bring up at one time or another, when the Holy Spirit tells you to, mention to people that we're in the last days. And now it's important they need to come to Christ, because if they don't, you're going to be telling them about their destiny. It's only heaven or hell. And if they believe it or not, it says, look, you're going against, if you say you don't believe in a heaven or hell, you're going against what Jesus said. And then, you know, I'd rather believe in Jesus, who said he was the truth, than people who think they know the truth and say truth is relative. It's relative to people outside of God. But when you know the truth is really absolute. That's why they're so far gone, because it's a veil over their eyes, and sin, and the flesh and sin, both, make that veil real thick, so they can't see. And it's only the Spirit of God, the light that you have within you, that can open their eyes to the truth. That's why it's so important for us to witness in these last days. The harvest is plentiful, the laborers are few. He brought you out of the world and brought you into his kingdom, into the sheepfold, into the church, not just to sit there, but to go out with your light into the world to those who sit in darkness, that they may see. That's what it's all about, folks. And that's what we're going to be getting into within a couple of weeks. I really look forward to it. I hope you look forward to his coming. I hope you are blessed this evening, as always. And Lord willing, we'll see you again. Thanks for listening in, and God bless you richly. Seek out the hopeless.
confused and torn.